Welcome back to part three of this eye-opener series about slavery in Islam. If you have been tracking with us and you've watched part one and part two, which I highly encourage you to do so, you will feel extremely, and I'm sorry to use this word, disgusted by the information shared in there. Yet, what fascinates me about the whole thing is like we are sharing Islamic-owned resources for this. And right now is no exception. We will continue to dig deeper. With me here is Dr. Jay Smith, who has done an amazing job in basically unpacking all this information for us. Thank you,
Lots
Dr. Jay.
Lots to unpack. And all I need to do is just put up reference after reference. All research by Sarah Foster, who is a descendant of slave, was absolutely disgusted by what she found. And that's why I'm sharing her material today. And as you said, it was difficult to read what you had to read. Now let's go to Muhammad himself. And let's look and see what the traditions say about this man, Muhammad. And so let's go back on the screen again, and let's look at his appearance. And when you look at his appearance, you will see, first of all, in al-Bukhari, that he had white leg shank. That's interesting. So he had white legs. Secondly, that he had white forearm in Ibn Dawud 3206. We notice that he also had white armpits in al-Bukhari 8, volume 8, volume 76, sorry, volume 8, and then
volume
also
book 78,
and then hadith number 631. And then also when you get to Bukhari 4, 56, 76 to 7, he had a white abdomen or white belly. When we get down to Al-Adab Mufra, he in 790, he had white skin. And then finally, with Sahih Muslim, he had a handsome white face. So in every, when we look at the traditions as the description of Muhammad, in every case, he is white, 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 white. White forearm, white armpits, white leg, white abdomen, white skin, and also white face. Al-Bukhari 1363 even calls him a white man. What is particularly troubling is when you continue on with that, take a look and see what Ibn Musa al-Yasunbi says. Anyone who says that the prophet was black should be killed. Boom. Hmm. So this to me is absolutely troubling. And what I'd like to say is when we look at this and we go through this, we can see that there's a real problem here because it's obvious that there is a disposition against anything that's black. We've seen this now in the traditions. We've seen this now in Muhammad's own references there. And now we get into early Muslim literature. And when we look at early Muslim literature, we see this coming up in the beginnings of 660. Now let's go back onto the slides again. This attitude is reflected in early Islamic period with the African origin poet named Suhaim in 660. Look and see what he says. Now this is an African himself. Look and see what he says.
If my color were pink, woman would love me, but the Lord has marred me with blackness. Though I am a slave, my soul is nobly free. Though I am black of color, my character is white. I am covered with a black garment, but under it there is a lustrous garment with white skirts.
I mean, you just almost have to cry when you read that.
That's
you can
right.
see how he's agonizing of his blackness. He just feels like he just feels dirty. He just feels wrong. Here's another example, and this is the black poet Abu Dalama, and look and see what he is saying from Algiers.
We're alike in color, our faces are black and ugly, our names are shameful.
Now, he's probably the best known of the early black poets writing in Arabic. He was a slave who became a court jester of the first Abbasid caliphs. And so you can see, long before the slave trade in the Atlantic slave trade, you have this kind of attitude by black people and African slaves, but by black people themselves. And let's look at this one here. This is by Jahiz of Basra, 776 to 869. So you're saying the 8th to 9th century. One of the greatest prose writers in classical Arabic literature and maybe partly of African descent. In his special essay, The Boast of the Blacks Against the Whites. Look and see what he says.
It's a part of your ignorance that in a time of heathendom, meaning like the
Jahiliya period,
you regarded us blacks as good enough to marry your woman. Yet when the justice of Islam came, you considered this wrong.
Hugely, hugely significant.
Oh, he's admitted the shift.
In fact, we hear just the opposite when we talk about when Muslims tell us all the time, the Jahiliya period is a time of ignorance. That's when everything went wrong. And that actually Islam came to eradicate.
Absolutely.
And brought back equality.
That's the narrative you hear all the time.
But here, look at the dates. He is from that period, and he is saying this is just the other way around. We, in the time of Jahiliyyah, we were actually equal. You let us marry your women, but no longer. So something came with the introduction of Islam that changed all of that. Now, I want to look at what Bernard Lewis, who is considered to be one of the greatest Orientalists, loved by Muslims because of his historical background. Look and see what he says. Let's put up the slide there and just go ahead and read what Bernard Lewis says.
He's saying black in Islam is somehow connected with sin, evil, deviltry, and damnation, while white has the opposite associations.
Let's continue on to the Quran itself. In the Quran, Surah 3, Ayah 106 says this.
On a day, meaning the day of resurrection, when some faces will become white and some faces will become black. As for those whose faces will become black, to them will be said, did you reject faith after accepting it? Then taste the torment in hell for rejecting faith.
Let's continue with another reference. Here is Surah 39, Ayah 60.
On a day of resurrection, you will see those who lied about Allah with their faces blackened. Is there not in hell a residence for the arrogant?
This idea that Bernard Lewis is talking about, this real reference between white and black, the idea that black is evil, white is good, could this be coming out of the Quran? Is that the source for this? Let's look at some of the traditions. Let's look at the Hadith and look at Jami' al-Tirmidhi. Let's see what he says, narrating from Ibn Abbas.
Yeah, Jami' al-Tirmidhi, Volume 2, says, Ibn Abbas narrated that the Messenger of Allah said, the black stone descended from the paradise, and it was more white than milk. Then it was blackened by the sins of the children of Adam.
So this narrative about evilness of blackness, that it changes and creates evilness, or is created by evilness, continues in the Hadith. It's not just in the Quran. Bukhari, look and see what he says.
Narrated Anas ibn Malik, Allah's messenger said, you should listen to and obey your ruler, even if he was an Ethiopian black slave whose head looks like a raisin.
So, again, you have a derision there. You have a reference point that seems to be confronting the whole notion that black, something's wrong with black.
And notice the example he used as a model for, even if he's like this, you should still listen to him.
Yeah, that's the worst, but still, you still listen to him. Now we get into Sunan al-Nasa'i.
Jabir said, a slave came and pledged to the Prophet to immigrate, and the Prophet didn't realize that he was a slave. Then his master came looking for him. The Prophet said, sell him to me. And he bought him for two black slaves. Then he did not accept the pledge from anyone until he asked, is he a slave?
So you can see Muhammad was caught into the same trap, and that almost the denigration. Now let's talk about the treatment of slaves, because the treatment, yeah, go ahead. You want to say something?
I was just going to say something. It's kind of interesting. He wouldn't accept the pledge of any black unless they tell him they're not a slave, as if it gives you the impression that, in general, blacks were slaves.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to come back to that. Hold on to that. Yes. Treatment of slaves. Dr. John Azuma, again, the one we referred to, who did his doctoral thesis on this very problem, mentions this. And this, let's go back and see what he says. And this is in his book, The Legacy of Arab Islam in Africa.
In areas like North Africa, the Middle East, and Turkey, black slaves did the meanest and hardest work. The first generation and plantation slaves in Muslim lands was as harsh and cruel as any other such system, while successive generations of all slaves had to live under the weight and stigma of racial and social discrimination.
So you can see the treatment of slaves was much worse for a black than it was for anybody else. And that could be possibly because of the reference that we have been going across. Now, Al-Tabari in the 10th century notes this.
He said that Zinj employed in groups, 500 to 5,000, salt marshes of southern Iraq. Their condition was extremely bad, and they were literally pinned down there, hopeless and homeless. The bad treatment, of course, led to numerous slaves revolts beginning
so in... So even Tabari in the 10th century was saying that this was quite normal. This bad treatment of black slaves was something that was not even considered to be a problem. Now, when we get to the maps of the slave, this is... I'm going to put this map up here. This is what you usually get from 639... you have the trade routes out of Africa and Asia. Have you look at those trade routes, and what do you notice? They all seem to go to the south, do they not?
That's right.
Now, what I want to do is I want to go back and I want to look and continue with what Bernard Lewis had said earlier. Remember, Bernard Lewis is a well-known Islamic apologist. At least Muslims like him. They think of him as apologist because he is the one that gives the best historical overview of Islam. Look at this quote that he says in Race and Slavery in the Middle East from 1990.
He said, the myth of Islamic racial innocence was a Western creation and served a Western purpose. In 18th century, the philosophers of the Enlightenment had praised Islam for its lack of dogmas and mysteries, its freedom from priests and inquisitors and other persecutors, recognizing real qualities but exaggerating them as a polemical weapon against the Christian church and clergy.
So this is a polemic by Westerners showing the romanticism of Islam in order to confront and ennoble or denigrate Christianity at that time. Davis Goldberg continues on, and he says, Lewis did not find anti-black sentiment in Arabia until the 7th century. Listen, look at the date. Until the 7th century conquest of Africa and the enslavement of its inhabitants. Snowden and Thompson similarly did not find a prejudiced view of blacks in ancient Greece or Rome. In those earlier times, color did not define a person and was not a criteria for categorizing humanity. In other words, what they're saying is these guys, Thomas and Snowden and Lewis, when they look back at the whole history of slavery, they found that this was something that this idea of colorism, this idea of black being bad, black being evil, black being part of the deviltry, that was introduced uniquely by Islamic scholars. This did not exist in Greek times. Every color was enslaved. It didn't exist in Roman time. Right. Everybody were slaves at that time. It didn't matter on your color. This idea of coloration was introduced by Islam. Here's another quote by James Harrell. Go ahead and read it.
Harrell said, Roman slaveholders were neither paternistic.
Paternalistic.
Paternalistic. Yeah, that's right. From far away. Nor racist in the modern sense of the term. Race itself is a modern construct. Although there were views about differing ethnicities in antiquity, there was no so-called scientific theory of skin-colored race until the 19th century.
Now, Davis Goldberg continues on from this, and he says, we first see this explicit link between skin color and slavery in Near Eastern sources beginning in the 7th century. We note its first appearance in the Christian West as soon as Europe discovered Black Africa and began to engage in the slave trade, which is much later. That's the 1400s. So 700 years later, this is now introduced in Christ, but it was first begun in the Muslim world, in the Near East. Hugely significant. Now, what we're going to do when we come back, and we need to stop there, I think, now, because we want to then pick up from this. We're then now going to look at the numbers itself. We're going to start getting to some of the most damaging material. We've looked at coloration. We've looked at the problem. Probably we now see that this coloration was introduced by Muslims themselves, by these great scholars like Ibn Khaldun, Ibn Sina, Ibn Taymiyyah. These what are considered household names of Islam, it's also introduced in the Quran in Surah 3 and also Surah 39. Muhammad is very clear that he had a problem with blacks. He had a problem with black color. But this idea of slavery having a distinction of coloration and gradation, that was introduced uniquely by Islam into the whole slave package. Now we're going to go and we'll move into a whole new area, and that is the numbers.
Absolutely. And of course, the whole thing is important for people to watch. And it's extremely an eye-opener, like I said earlier. And we thank you, of course, for taking the time to share in this fabulous research by, once again, want to give her credit.
What's her Sarah name? Foster.
Sarah Foster. We thank her for that. And I hope others will benefit from this amazing data that we're sharing with you. And what is so sad is majority of this information is coming from the Islamic sources, or Orientalists are quoting also Islamic resources or comparing Islamic history to what's going on recently. Until we meet again, of course, have a fabulous day. Thanks for watching. Make sure to like and subscribe so that you don't miss future videos. And please consider becoming a patron on patreon.com/CRI International.